was a problem recording last class, so I'm going to take a minute to review what we did in last class. I published instead the lecture from last semester, which I guess is handy, but I like the example that we came up with in class, so I want to spend a minute talking about it before we move on and expand upon it. I did pretty much the same thing in the other lecture, just with a different example, and I provided that example as well. So what we did last time was a frequently asked questions page, and it was a real good example to cover the stuff that we had talked about before and introduce some new ideas in it. So let's look at it. This is what the page looks like. And let's look at the features of the page. First of all, we have a little bit of color in it. Yay. All right. We use this to talk about, to introduce CSS. We have our HTML5 structural tags. That is, we have a heading, we have a navigation, and we have several sections, and finally we have a footer. All right. We have a link to an external page, this one right here. We have a link internal to our page, so we can go to a particular section of the page or back to top. And finally, in our footer, we have an email link, which doesn't really work in this on this computer because I don't have my email set up correctly. So if you click that, if a person had their email set up, it would automatically open their email, and they'd be good to go. So let's take a look and review the code that's in this page. I'm going to leave the style for last, because that's what we're going to pick up on today. All right. Notice that this page has a document type. As the HTML head, inside the head is the title, then it has the body, and then HTML. I finished grading lab one, and most of you that turned it in did a good job on it. The one thing I deducted for is a lot of people forgot the HTML tag, the doc type, the head, the body. And so rework it for credit if you have not done that correct. All right, these are the HTML5 structural tags, as we call them. We have a header tag that represents sort of the banner of the page. All right. It's important that a website and web pages identify their purpose so you know what they are at a glance. You wouldn't want to get to a web page and not have any idea like what was the page about or what was the site about or what organization is putting on this page. So you have a banner that says what the page is about. In that I use my H1s and P's, and I also have a link, and that link is an external link, so it's a link to some other page other than my own, and it's accomplished with the A href equals, but included in the quotes is the address of a page, http://lorainecc.edu. My My navigation is an ordered list. The ordered list makes it numbered. I could have just as well used an unordered list. It's in the nav section because this is how I get around my page. Notice it has a link, but it doesn't have a full URL. It has the pound sign or the hashtag or the number sign, depending on how old you are. That tells you to go to a certain section of the page. In this case, when I click on this link, I go to the thing that has an ID of HTML answer. That's what the pound sign represents within a web page. The thing that has that as an ID. And likewise, this link takes you there, and this link takes you to the JavaScript section. It's an ordered list, so each list item is a numbered list item. 1, 2, 3. All right. For each of the topics, I have a section tag. It's just an additional way to organize the page with a section tag. We talked about other tags that you could use, articles and asides. And I talked about how you don't necessarily want to agonize over what the right tag is. That you can, some things you could call a section or you could call an article and it really doesn't matter. Just like an order list versus an unordered list. I could call the questions on this page an unordered list, and that's fine. Alright, it doesn't really change things that much. Finally, I have my footer that contains an email link where the href is mailed to and then my email address. And when I click it, if email has been set up on that machine, it will bring up their email client and away I can go. That's within a footer. So you use these HTML5 structural tags to sort of section out your page into sections. Because there's common sections in most every page. There's going to be a banner, there's going to be a navigation, there's going to be articles or sections, and there's going to be a footer. Any questions about any of this? All right, we ended class by talking about style. And I used color to do style, but I could have used a lot of different things. We could have used font, for example. Now, over the next class or so, depends on how long it goes, you know, I'm going to be talking about color and maybe a couple other things. But know that throughout the semester, we are going to come back and talk about CSS alongside of HTML. All right, so we'll talk about a little bit about some HTML, we'll talk about a little bit about some CSS, and so on. CSS allows us to change the way that the page looks and the way that the page is laid out. Almost anything that you can describe visually is something that relates to CSS. So in this case, my CSS, I have part of the same page. I have a style tag in the head section that says this is the style I want to use. Now, the CSS for a page consists of selectors and attribute pairs. The selector is what on the page gets this rule. And then the attribute pairs are what it is we're changing about that element. The first kind of selector we saw is an HTML tag. H1, H2, those are HTML tags. What that is saying is that everything on the page that has that tag gets a background of yellow. So every H1 on the page has a background of yellow. Every H2 has a background of orange. So we could do this for every single tag on our page. We could make paragraphs a different color still, if we wanted to. We could make sections a different color, if we wanted to. Now, color is only one thing that we can do. We could make them different fonts. We could make them a bigger font. We could make them smaller fonts. We could make text a different color. We could put a border around them. We could give them a different width. We could give them a different height. We could give them a different position. Again, it's not just about color, but color is the easiest thing to identify. I encourage you, if you want to play with anything else with CSS, you're welcome to do so. All right? You can find very easily on the W3 Schools site, which is a nice little tutorial for people beginning web development. Learn CSS, and they show an example of how to change the font to something else, how to change the font size. What's nice about these tutorials is it gives you an example, and you can play with it. Click run, and it will go and it will make the change for you to show what it looks like. What if I say blue instead of light blue? What if I say aqua? Now, I can't just type in any color that I've dreamed up or that I've seen in Sherwin-Williams or in my 128 crayon box of crayons, right? There are certain HTML color names that are the allowable ones. And here's a list of them. I could say, make the background of my page khaki if I wanted to. Or make the H1s, make the H2s khaki. Then I can go and refresh it, and it's going to look different. So there's a whole bunch of colors. That I can put in that the browser will recognize. But there's a finite number of colors. You have a lot more flexibility even beyond the named colors. You can sort of mix your own colors with HTML. And you do that by combining three primary colors, red, green, and blue. All right. Let's imagine that you have up on the ceiling mounted three different lights. Maybe you remember those old big screen TVs. All right. A lot of times they were in like restaurants or whatever. They would have three lamps. One was red, one was green, and one was blue. And it would project the image in those three different colors, and if the TV was set up right, it aligned right, and it gave you color. All right? Gave you regular color. Color on a web page is similar to that. We can give the values for red, green, and blue, and specify colors that way. All right? So, and it goes in that order, RGB. Sometimes if you look like in digital image manipulation, they'll talk about the RGB value. It means red, green, and blue. So I can specify colors, by, instead of by their name, I can specify them by their RGB value. So I can say RGB 255 00. And what does that mean? Means it's the values of the three color lights that I'm combining. First one is red. The value for each of those three numbers has to be between 0 and 255. 255 is the highest number that you can go using this syntax. So I have the red turned all the way up, 255. I have the green and the blue as low as you can go, zero. So this will be a very bright shade of red. This will be the brightest red that we can get. Because I say R, red's all the way up, no green, no blue. So if I save this and look at the page, that's like red, red. All right? Can't get redder than that. If I move this number down, what's it going to be?
11 shade of red.
Not a lighter shade of red, but a darker shade of red, because I'm turning down the red light. So instead of the red light being full blast, the red light's like at about half blast now. So it would be a darker shade of red. So there's a darker shade of red. What if I wanted a pinkish color? Well, I could do that by effectively adding some white to it. Or adding the other colors. So if I did something like this, can't add any more red, so I'm going to add some red and I'm going to add some blue and green to it. So there's a lighter shade of pink. If I put these numbers high enough, it's essentially going to be white with just a touch of reddish tint to it. All right. Now here's the good news with this, is you don't need to know how to do this, but you can do this. And I think it's important to understand how you come up with colors on the web. All right. There's actually another way to represent colors on the web, and that's with a hex code. A hex code has a series of three pairs of hexadecimal numbers. What's a hexadecimal number? Hexadecimal is base 16. So in our normal decimal system, the numbers go 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. In hexadecimal, they go 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, A, B, C, D, E, F. All right? So the highest value in hex is FF. And the lowest number is 00. So this is the equivalent of saying RGB 255 00. Because in both cases we have red full blast and we have green and blue nothing. So these two will give you the same shade of red. That very, very bright red. So if I wanted to make this more of a pinkish shade, I could put in EE. That would add some green and blue to the mix. And so again, we have a very light pink. It might even be impossible. Well, you can sort of see that that's pink. Now here's the good news. You might not understand anything that I said there, but you can still use colors by using color charts. So I can look up I guess this has a chart, but that's not what I want. If I like this shade of green, it tells me that that is 00FF33. So I can just copy that there, put that in my web page, and I'm good to go. Remember, the hex codes start with the pound sign. So pound sign 00FF33, that will give me that particular shade of green. That matches up exactly to that. If I want this shade of green for the other ones, I can copy that and put that in here. So there's three ways you can specify a color. One of the ways is with the name. And there's a lot of names that are defined, but not every color has a name. You can specify it via the RGB value, or you can specify it using the hex code. All right. Now, it's easy to define colors. It's a little harder to define colors that go well together. All right? Now, you know, in just real life, there's some people, even with their clothing, that just have a knack of putting together an outfit, you know, that really looks good and really mixes colors good and everything matches and it looks great. And there's other people, such as myself, that struggle with that. All right? Fortunately, there's a science to what colors go together and what colors don't. And by exploring that, we can come up with, even if we're not really good naturally at putting colors together, we can define colors that go well together. So, I'm going to Google HTML color scheme generator. There's any number of these, and try them out. Try different ones out, see which ones you like. I'm going to pick this one. I think that's the one that I use. All right. And with this one, you get to pick a couple of things. You get to pick, first of all, what style do you want? Monochromatic will generate like one color, all right, and different shades of the color that match each other, all right? Adjacent colors will generate colors that are not all based on the same color, but are all match well together. Triad will generate colors that go together well together, but contrast. And this one, I believe it's tetrad, gives you four colors where there's even a wilder contrast between them. I usually keep it simple and stick with monochromatic. So I'm going to pick monochromatic, and I'm going to say I want the main color of my site to be, let's say, this kind of shade of blue. What this gives me is I think, five colors that I can use that I know are going to go good together. All right? Now, a few things to keep in mind. First of all, what if you wanted to use more than five colors? Well, I'd be careful with that, right? Because if you use too many colors, you're liable to be overwhelming and confusing the user. All right, remember why we are using colors. We're using colors to look good, to be sure, but we're also using colors to help guide the user so that they can understand these different sections of the page that you're dealing with. The other thing to remember is that you always have the so-called neutral colors, the whites, the grays, to add to your color palette. So five colors is actually typically going to be enough. All right. So what I'm going to do is, if I put my mouse over this, it tells me that's 4A, 6A, 8A. So I'm going to go and I'm going to make this have 4A, 6A, 8A as a background. Background of the other one, I'm going to make 738, CA6. And 2B4C6F, I'm going to make my different one. 2B4C6F. So if I run this together, I have a color scheme that the science of color has determined is appropriate for my pages. All right? As you can tell, it does look pretty good that way. There's my different one. All right? Now, I might say this is a little hard to read. Maybe even that's a little hard to read. I can change the color of the font as well. Background is a background color. Color is the color I can use for the font. And I could use white if I wanted to, because remember, white and black are always in play. All right? They almost don't count when you're considering how many colors that you're using. Or I could pick another one of these, maybe for the type. So maybe I'll take 041D37. 041D37. Might make it a little easier to read and give it a little bit of visual flair and interest. Remember, we do colors for a couple reasons. We don't necessarily want, we want our page to look good, but that's not necessarily the only reason. We want to give a sense of our organization, and we want to, quote, brand our organization. We also use colors to help organize our page. So instead of one big block of data, we now have colored bars that sort of break this page up into sections. And hopefully that will allow the users to more easily find different pieces of information on the page. Questions? Now, the one thing I didn't talk about is cascading style sheets. Sometimes two rules can apply to the same thing. Now, in this case, I have JS Answer that has its own rule. And JS Answer is this H2 right here. It's an H2. And it also has an ID of JS Answer. The pound sign means that it's not an HTML tag, but it's an ID that gets this rule. So which rule does it get? Does it get the rule for the H2, or does it get the rule for JS Answer? Well, it actually gets both rules. All right. Which one applies, though? Which one overrides which? The more specific one overrides the less specific one. In this case, H2 and JS Answer both define the background color. But JS Answer is a more specific, is pointing just to that one thing. So that's more specific than saying a rule for all H2s. Therefore, JS answer gets a background of pound sign 2B, 4C, 6F. JS answer doesn't have, however, a color defined for it. Therefore, it gets the color from the H2 rule. And that might not be real easy to see. Let's make it obvious by putting a color of like yellow here. Notice that one has this one that has an ID, gets its background color from this style rule, but is also an H2, so it gets the color from that. So the more specific is going to override the more general. But if the more specific doesn't have an attribute defined, then it will get the attribute defined for the more general rule. That's sort of the cascading part of a cascading style rule. That's where the word cascading comes from, is that things get their attributes, things can get their attributes from multiple rules, and they sort of trickle down from more specific to least specific, or the other way around. Questions on this?
Yeah, Mike, so the order doesn't matter.
No.
No, okay. For some reason I thought the JS answer overrode H2.
No, what matters is the specificness of it in this case. Now, later on you will see examples when the order does matter. All right. The order would matter, for example, if I had two style rules for just H2. But what's more important in this example is the specificity of it. The fact that the JS answer is more specific. Yes?
After the font color, does it get a semicolon or does it not? Because
it should.
Okay.
It should, but again, that's one of the cases where
it works either way.
The browser figures out what you want and does it, even though you didn't follow the rules precisely. Okay, we're going to look at another kind of link, all right? And I'm going to change this back to... website doesn't have one page, but it has more than one page. That's certainly a common occurrence. Alright? So, let's say in this site, in addition to the web development FAQ, there was a page that was my biography. Alright? You know, where I've taught before, where I went to school, etc. And this is going to be a different kind of link than what we've seen before. It's not going to be a link to an outside website, so I don't need the full URL. It's not a link internal to my page. It's a link to another page that I've created. So let me save this. I'm going to save it as bio. Then I'm going to create a couple of headings, education and teaching experience. Save this and open it up. Now notice a couple things. First of all, it looks, it has the same basic look because I copied and saved the original web page that included the CSS code. But I might want to have a link back to the FAQ page, and I might want the FAQ page to have a link to the bio page. All right. So how do I do that? Well, it's a link, but I want to make this a link to my FAQ page. So how do I do that? Well, we know that it is a href equals something. Now, this isn't any of the kind of links that we've seen before. I'm going to assume, first of all, that this page is in the same folder as these two pages are in the same folder, which they are. If they're in the same folder, I just need to give the name of the page. Now when I click it, see FAQ page, I click on the link, it takes me to that page. Click back, I go back to that page. Now, for good measure, I'm going to put a link on this page to go to my bio page. So I'm going to go and open this guy. Now my two pages are linked together. Generally speaking, if you turn in an assignment that has more than one page, I should be able to navigate around it by clicking links. All right, we'll talk more about good navigation sections later on, but we should have a link between all the pages so I can get anywhere from anywhere. So now if I open up the FAQ page, I can get to the bio page. If I get to the bio page, I can go back to the FAQ page. Pretty nifty. And again, it's still a link. The only difference is the href, assuming they're in the same folders, you don't need that HTTP, you don't need the pound sign, you don't need email to or mail to, you simply need the name of the page. and it will call that page up. Questions? There's the last thing we're going to, well, I don't know if it's the last thing we're going to do today. Here's the next thing we're going to do today. It's a goal in design to make all your pages have a consistent look. That's important. You don't want people confused and thinking that they landed somehow on another website. So you want your pages to have a consistent look to it. So, right now, my CSS code lives in two places. CSS code is in the bio page, it's in the FAQ page. Let's say, for example, I go in and say, you know what? It would look better if the background, it would look better if the text color is white for the H2s. And I make that change. That change took place on the FAQ page, but if I go back to my bio page, it still has the old values. Why is that?
Because there are two different pages.
There's two different pages, and I have the code in two different places. Here's the one page with my CSS code. Here's my other page with the old CSS code. It'd be nice if we could put all that CSS code in one place. Well, as it turns out, we can. All right, and that's called an external CSS file. And that's what we're going to do. So I'm going to say, create a new file. And I'm going to take, and I'm going to cut out of my web page the style information. And I'm going to get rid of the style tag. I don't need the style tag in here because it's not part of my web page anymore. All right. Then I'm going to save it with a name. And I'm going to save it as a name of main.css. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to change each of these two pages to point to that page, to that CSS code. And it's done with a link tag, but it's a different kind of link tag. It's not a link tag where you click on something and go to another page. It is like this. Copy that to the other one. When I use the external approach, there's no style tags anymore. I have all my CSS code in a file, and then I use a link tag to link to it. So I'm going to save everything, and now I'm going to go back and forth, and notice that now their CSS is the same. Now, if I did that with two files, I could do that with 200 files, right? I could have all 200 files pointing to the same CSS file. And that's great, right? Because what if I want to change something about the page, all right? What if I want to make it so that so that my paragraphs have a gray background, all right? don't know if that's a good idea or not, but we'll say we do. All I have to do is go into the one CSS file and say, paragraph. Background. Gray. Save it. Hit refresh. This page has a change. And this page has a change. So, like that, I could change it at a, you know, at a sweeping to make a change on all my websites. So if you work for a company and they are rebranding themselves and they have a new logo with different colors, you wouldn't have to go to every single page and make the changes to the new color set. You could just go in one place and make the changes. If your business is seasonal, around Christmas time you might want one color scheme, or around Thanksgiving you might want a different color scheme, 4th of July another color scheme, right? You wouldn't have to go and change every single one of your web pages. You could just go and make the change to a single CSS file. Alright? And again, a gigantic benefit to that. Alright? Because one of the things that we want to do is we want to make things easy to change. Because we know we're going to have to change our website at some point. Therefore, the easier we can make those changes, the better it is. Could you see, for example, if your boss woke up one morning and said, you know what, I think all our paragraphs should be gray, and you didn't put things in an external style sheet file, and you went into all 200 of your pages and changed them to gray, then your boss looks at it and says, man, on second thought, that's ugly, change it back. Well, if you changed all 200 separately, you're going to have to all change all 200 back. If, however, your code was set up to where the CSS lived in one place, you just need to change that one place, and boom, you're back in business. The next time someone refreshes the page. Are there any questions about this? Yes?
Could I just see the code in, not the CSS code, but like a reference to it?
Yeah. And I will post this example as well. But the first two things tell the browser, hey, you're dealing with CSS. And the href tells the browser, here's the name of the CSS file. Questions? All right, I will go and make sure that the lab is open, then I'll come back here, gather my files, and then I'll be back in.